No?
I understand. She doesn't think it's still at 7:30, I hope. Mm-hmm. Well, oh, yeah. If she doesn't make it, we can skip that section.
Good evening, and welcome to the April 10th, 2007 school board meeting. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Adjustments to the agenda. Alan, you have a couple, I believe.
We have a couple of adjustments that we'd like to take a look at under comments by high school and middle school students. Right after that is a 4A. We would do the baseball boosters agreement, and Mrs. Millett would present that, and we also have a contract for that. Under 8, the superintendent's report, we'll add 8B, which is for the senior trip. Under new business, I have one thing that just came in today. I have a retirement, so that will be added to the list, and I will take that up when that time comes. And I think...
What number did you want to put?
I would go right under my consideration of superintendent's recommendations for athletic positions.
11F?
So 11F, yep.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Kevin?
I have two to offer.
Okay.
The first is relative to a motion to charge the superintendent and DLT with a formal review of scheduling in the schools. And the second is a motion to affirm Karen Burke as our representative to the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation.
Okay.
In accordance with our appointments policy.
Thank you. Where should we be putting these?
I'm sorry, that should be under new business.
Okay. So a G.
11G and 11H.
And an H.
Right.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Moving on. Approval of the March school board minutes. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the school board minutes for the March 13th business meeting.
Thanks, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Linda? Discussion? Corrections? Changes? Okay. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Comments by high school and middle school students. Let's start with the middle school first.
So, this week started the spring sports schedule. That includes boys and girls, 7th and 8th grade lacrosse, 7th and 8th grade softball, 7th and 8th grade baseball, and 6th, 7th, and 8th grade outdoor track. As of now, all the teams are practicing inside or in the gym until the snow clears up and we're able to use the fields again. The next dance is going to be Friday, April 27th. This will be the last dance that's going to be run by the student council. Also, 8th graders recently took part in a grade-wide assessment. They had to write a script for a radio or TV advertisement. This took place following a propaganda unit that the whole grade took part in. At the April 27th dance, there will be a fundraiser for the last dance, which is not a student-run dance. Students will be able to pay a dollar, and they will get a chance to throw a whipped cream pie at either Mr. Casey or Mr. Connolly. I think this should be a lot of fun. And lastly, MEA testing is going to be for grade 6 on Monday, April 30th, and Tuesday, May 1st, and for grade 5 on Wednesday, May 2nd, and Thursday, May 3rd.
Thank you.
Hi. The middle school is running a magazine drive, and 40% of the cost of the magazines goes to the middle school. And these magazines cost no more than they usually do. The 5th and 6th grade social is tomorrow, April 11th, at the middle school, and there will be a moon bounce and gym games. Nothing But Nets campaign, which prevents malaria in Africa, ends on Friday. Next week is vacation, April 14th to the 23rd. Into the Woods is the middle school spring production. The performances are Thursday, April 26th at 2:30, Saturday, April 28th at 2 and 7, and Sunday, April 29th at 2:30. There's a sixth grade Chewonki meeting April 24th at 7 in the middle school cafeteria. And the cost for Chewonki this year is $90. It was $80 last year, but the price went up because this year the gift wrap sales went down, so it's more expensive this year. May 1st is the 7th and 8th grade band performance at the high school at 7 o'clock. And May 2nd is the all-chorus night where the middle school and high school students will be performing at the high school at 7 also. And there's a 5th and 6th grade band concert May 3rd at the high school at 7. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, by the way, is there some way the school board can get in on the deal of throwing whipped cream pies at the middle school administrators?
Okay, in the high school?
Okay, today I was lucky enough to go to the Natural Helper Spring Conference, and it was a really cool program. There were a lot of cool courses to take. The AP history class went to, senior history class went to, down to Washington, D.C., and they had a really good time. They made a video of it that I bet you could see online on the video production website. The juniors put on a fashion show to raise money for prom, and I think that went over well. Forum was canceled, so I can't really give you a review of that. Let's see. A big thing at the at the end of March and early April was college. People hearing from colleges, and this is the most selective year for colleges ever, if you looked at the news reports. So that was an interesting thing that students went through. And that welcomed us into fourth quarter. And Mr. Soul, the Latin teacher, says, "No beast is harder to tame than a senior in spring," and that's probably ending up to be a little true. I think that covers everything.
Students have been kind of complaining about how our school has kind of a lack of a really organized recycling program, which is kind of coming at a good time because the week after vacation, the Environmental Club is holding an Environmental Awareness Week, and we're going to have really organized recycling, and we're also going to have a pledge that students can participate in, which they kind of, it just kind of shows their awareness. They get a bracelet, and it shows that they're more aware of what they're doing, whether it means, you know, just making sure that they recycle or, you know, just not driving around so much, catching rides, carpooling. And there's also going to be some organic food that's going to be for samples at the cafeteria, and also a showing of An Inconvenient Truth, which people are looking forward to. And tomorrow, the Gay Straight Alliance is holding the Day of Silence, which is just kind of, it recognizes the hardships that homosexuals go through when they're, because all the pressures that they're put under to not reveal what they're going through. So students will dress in all black and kind of wear a gay awareness pin just to show their support. And we're having a dance on the Saturday after we get back from vacation. It's going to be held by the music club, and we're going to have more live music. So that's pretty much it for now.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Questions?
Any questions?
Comments?
Are you guys all going to be riding the bus the week of, or all the juniors and seniors going to be riding the bus to help with global warming during the Environmental Awareness Week?
I give rides. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to recognition, I have a few recognitions to read this evening.
You have a 4A, first of all, the baseball.
Thank you. I knew I'd miss it. Okay, baseball booster agreement. Rebecca, do you want to fill us in?
Sure. The Finance Committee, bear with me, met on March 28th, and Roger Boynton came to speak to us about a proposal that the baseball boosters had for putting signage in Holman Field. He basically explained that the signs would be similar to the ones that are in the Lions Field, that's correct? And would keep within the town sign ordinances and would be on the side fences. The reasons that they are coming forward with this proposal is that they are trying to repair the batting cage at the high school, which would cost around $1,800, and eventually to also eliminate the payment of dues. The committee discussed this to some extent and basically agreed to recommend to the board that we, on a trial basis for this season only, allow the baseball boosters to put signs up. Also to basically sign an agreement with the superintendent stipulating, and Alan, are you going to forward these up
yes,
to the
yes,
members?
Yes, right, yeah.
Good, I need it because I need to be able to summarize it. Agreeing to obeying, following ordinances and checking with the superintendent for approval for content, and there are some basic guidelines. The guidelines are to avoid religious food, smoking, alcoholic sexual products, and any information that may entice student purchases of inappropriate materials. Actually, that's not quite what I had asked for, but so Roger is here tonight if you have any questions for him. But I, at this point, would we be taking a vote, Kathy? Oh, okay, hold on. Alan?
When I heard you do the minutes, it dawned on me. On the 1, 2, 3, fourth paragraph, this agreement is in effect from July 11th, 07. I had put June 1st, 08. It should be June 30th, 07, since it's only the first year.
Right. And then after the season, we would kind of check in to see how it went. Also, I had made a suggested change to the agreement to say basically restrict it to not including any direct marketing to students. So, you know, stonework, I think I listed in the minute summary that some of the current or people that are interested are a car dealer, stonework company, law firm, masonry firm, testing company. These are all pretty much marketing to adults, so it would easily fit within those guidelines, but I would have an issue if any signs were being targeted directly to the students, whether it's inappropriate or appropriate. So, Alan, if I could, I'd like to just suggest that we strike out, any direct marketing, any marketing directed at students is probably what I would just say.
So maybe we could just reaffirm what that sentence would say so everybody's
sure
on that.
Cape Elizabeth School Board also limits the advertising on the sides to avoid religious, food, smoking, alcoholic, sexual products, and any marketing directed at students.
And maybe I'd ask also if anybody has any questions for Mr. Boynton since he's is here to answer any questions that the board might have. Did you want to say something, too? Sure.
I appreciate everybody's support in this. Again, everybody understands that all boosters organizations are there to benefit the teams, and they become a very important part of athletics and a supporter. Again, without this type of activity, you know, we're unable to do things that are necessary for our program. And, you know, we already start off, we pay for an additional coach and things like that, so it's important that we have this type of revenue done right to rely on, and I appreciate your support.
One of the reasons why we put such a short time frame on is that we are currently going to be working on an advertising policy for the district, so we felt that
we could try it on a trial basis, and then whatever the policy is, we could keep that in alignment with ever, however we move forward.
Rebecca, do you want to make a motion?
I guess I would. I have to think about what it would sound like. I'd like to move that we approve the use of signs at Holman Field for the baseball boosters for the 2007 season, and the agreement as drafted this evening to be signed between the district and the baseball boosters.
With the two changes.
With the changes we discussed, yes.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Linda? Mm-hmm. Discussion? No? Okay. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Roger.
Now we'll move on to recognition, right?
Sure.
Keep me straight, Ellen. Okay. Okay. We have four recognitions this evening. I apologize for reading it, but that's the best way for me to get it out. First of all, this is from Sue Weatherby, I believe. Sue can correct me if I get it wrong. We tied for first place with Deer Isle to become the 2007 Maine State K-6 Scholastic Chess Team Champions. While technically co-champions upon tie breaks, based upon the performance of the opponents faced, we were awarded the first place trophies and Deer Isle received the second place hardware. Our top five team members were Brett Parker, Alex Silva, Danny Brett, Matthew Fishbein, and Wesley Parker. The other K-6 team members contributing to the win were Nicholas Shedd, Jack Demeter, thank you, Ethan Dupere, Matthew Riel Hatem, thank you. I'll have you read this. Colin Smith, Will Krieger, and Leo Wing. While too old to play in the K-6 section, seventh graders Peter Campbell and Shannon Daly can rightly claim some of the credits for the victory as well, since it was their persistence over the years that helped grow the team. At the 2007 Maine State Scholastic Chess Individual Tournament, Wesley Parker, second grade, won all four of his games in the K-3, taking clear first place and reportedly winning most of his games in under 5 minutes rather than the 90 minutes allotted. He takes the title of 2007 Maine State K-3 champion, previously held by Matthew Fishbein in 2006. Matthew Fishbein, third grade, played up to the K-6 elementary tournament, also winning all four of his games and taking first place. He now holds the title of 2007 Maine State elementary champion. Brett Parker, sixth grade, was one of the several players who tied for second place in this K-6 tournament. Though she came in sixth, the performance of Shannon Daly in the K-8 tournament is also noteworthy because she lost only to the tournament champion. Next is a memo from Adam Killip saying that the Higgins-Killip team in fifth grade raised about $250 selling hot chocolate to go to Nothing But Nets, and the Welch-Whaley team raised additional funds. And this is for just middle school. Okay, Nothing But Nets. All right, thanks.
Yeah, which is about the
mosquito netting.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Kathy?
Yes.
On the next one, I typed the girl's name wrong. It's Hawk instead of Hawks. It's Ruby with no ES on.
We'll get that right, can we? Okay, we'll try. Thank you, Mary. Yep. Andy Strout sent us an email saying, the annual fundraiser for the American Heart Association, sponsored by the Middle School Physical Education Department, has produced an outstanding young lady. Ruby Hawkins, a fifth grader in Mrs. Walsh's class, has raised an amazing $2,000 and growing. Her dream of winning an electric scooter has happened. In fact, she will receive two scooters, which she will be giving one to her friend.
And I just got an update tonight from Mr. Conley that her total is up to $2,300 now.
Wow.
Wow.
Thank you, Mary. Holy smokes. And the last one is from Mary Hart with reference to Chloe Brown. Chloe Brown has received an award titled the Silver Key Award for a photographic self-portrait at the national level,
All the states compete from the Scholastic Art Awards. At the local level, Chloe received two Gold Key Awards for a photographic piece and a ceramic sculpture. Did I miss anything? No. Okay. On to number six, comments from the public on non-agenda items. Is there anyone here from the public that would like to comment on non-agenda items? Seeing none, we'll move on to communications. 7A, update on legislative issues. Alan?
Yes. What I would comment on is, as you know, if you've been watching the paper and even read it this morning, that the Appropriations Committee is still working on legislative issues around consolidation. I was in Augusta on Monday. They are still in the process of trying to finalize some of that information. I have a booklet, a fairly large booklet, which I think comes to a point where we need to sit as a board and share that information. I will be back in Augusta on Friday, I think it's June 27th, and that's where we'll get the final rundown of what is happening at the state level, and therefore begin to look at the calendar of events that need to occur, including the first one, which is July 1st of this year. And so I will put that all together and go over it with you. I will send copies to you so you can look at it before we meet, just so you have some sense of where that is. I would also tell you that there are 1,839 bills in the legislature, of which many of those are educational bills dealing with many different aspects of education. And those are in the process right now. This is a heavy-duty week for the legislature because they're trying to get ready for vacation next week. And so they are taking up a lot of those bills at this point.
Alan, may I ask,
yes.
Did you get a sense of the potential success for the Appropriations Subcommittee proposal?
The sense was that I heard the other day is that even if the Senate votes in favor of it, that the House will probably not get the two-thirds vote to make it happen, and so therefore it'll probably return either to the Department of Education or to the legislative board at that point in time to relook at. But the sense is neither, it certainly won't pass the legislature, could pass the Senate, but it has to pass both with a two-thirds vote.
Is that normal?
It's on a bill like this, yes, it is. Yeah. So that's what the word was on Monday.
Thank you.
Thank you. Superintendent's report. Update on plans for completion of Pond Cove Playground construction. I believe that's Tom.
I think you've seen in your packet the update from Lisa and Suzanne about the playground. But for people who might be hearing it for the first time, the all of the playgrounds in Cape Elizabeth were examined 4 or 5 years ago. Pond Cove was in disrepair, middle school needed some work, and through the generous support of town funds, grants from the state, an incredible amount of fundraising, we were able to do the first couple of phases of the long-term plan, including the one out at Fort Williams. At that time, we weren't quite sure what was going to happen to the lower half of the Pond Cove playground. We've made some improvements since then through the PCPA, but now that the kindergarten wing is out there, that area is really defined, and Lisa and Suzanne, who have done a lot of work helping with natural science too, have worked with teachers and the climate committee to come up with some ideas and come up with this sketch. So we're here to answer questions about it, or you can come walk around on the map actually to do that. I do want to really thank Lisa and Suzanne for doing this because everybody has an opinion about what should be out there. And the original plan, although it was pretty good, this is even better because it's not just a playground, it should be a learning area. If you look at the map and get oriented correctly, you'll see an outdoor classroom space out there. The other thing that we're hoping to promote and make bigger too is the community garden. Gail Schmader has helped run that for years, and we're hoping that with more classrooms out there, not just playing kickball, but relating to the grounds more educationally, we'll be able to pretty up the playground more. And it is a great place to run around. So. Any questions about the, yeah?
Just a comment. If I could stand up and jump and clap, I would.
Oh, go ahead.
I don't think that would be appropriate on air, but I, having sat on the playground committee with Lisa 5 years ago, this is phenomenal that you stuck with it. It's only taken 5 years, but this is even better. I agree. We worked hard at that plan, and it was sad not to see that third phase go, but this is even better, so maybe it was worth the 5-year wait. Thank you for sticking with it.
Lisa's done a great job, and we've met a personal goal. We did advocate for mud on the first one, and we have our mud now.
Well,
any questions?
I'll just thank you for all of this work, you and Suzanne and everybody else that's done this. This is wonderful, absolutely wonderful.
You should be standing here. Right?
Yeah.
I think the map says it all. It looks very child-friendly to me, and because who's the name of our consultant who has donated his time? Todd has helped sketch it out there that we've been able to walk around. Some of the grown-ups have walked around, and the kids have looked at it because he marked it, and I think that's gotten people more excited about it. We'll have to figure out the actual logistics when it's done. Oh, the other good news is we have money. Grants have come in to help pay for it.
I was going to say we'd probably be remiss if we didn't thank, at least publicly, the people that you would put in this letter, which is the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, the Portland Trails Association, the Pond Cove Teaching Community, and the PCPA. So thanks.
And you know, I'm fine. That's not total funding yet. We're still looking to, we're soliciting some additional grants, and those remain to be seen, as well as we're going to need a lot of donations, both materials, supplies.
It's a great project. Thanks. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Kate B., senior trip?
Yes. You all received an email, I believe it was yesterday, from Aaron Grady-Gallant, who is the co-chair of this Cape Elizabeth High School Project Graduation 2000 project. What she brought to me was a rundown. I had met with them earlier this year to talk about it, and as I had talked with her at the time, we were in the process of a new travel policy. And so she brought to me yesterday the plan for the day, also brought me the permissions for the different parts of the trip that will be there. The trip is an overnight trip, but it's not a sleeping trip, as you probably know, and is within the limits that are prescribed by the policy. So I'm just bringing this to you for information, to know that I have reviewed the entire packet and will approve this. I cannot sit here and tell you where they're going because it's top secret. Mm-hmm. And but anyway, they will have a great time. So,
any questions, Alan? Are we invited? Thank you.
If you're a junior parent.
Yeah, you're a junior parent.
There we go. Okay, moving on to the school reports. We're hearing from the high school tonight on the arts program. Are we going to need to move, Gary? Probably. Okay.
While Mary and Gary are setting up, I'll just introduce Mary Hart. This is Mary Hart. She is one of our visual arts teachers at the high school. She is the co-chair of the entire arts department as well. And one of the interesting things that Mary brings to the arts department at the high school is she is half of her career is teaching at the high school. So she's a half-time teacher with us, and the other half is she is a professional artist on her own, and her art is featured in the Portland Museum of Art. I think she's got a painting on permanent display at the Portland Museum of Art, and I think it was time to put on display after talking about PSATs and MEAs and SATs and all those and budget, which will be coming up. About another dimension of the high school program, which Mary is integral to and which she is happy to share with you tonight. So this is an introduction to the Cape Elizabeth Visual Arts Program. Mary.
Thank you, Jeff. Gary, do I need to talk to the microphone? Can you close that? Okay. And can we turn the lights off? The room lights?
Sorry, I'm kind of a newcomer to this, so I'm figuring out the technology. I didn't realize Gary needed to set it all up beforehand, so we'll just flow into it. When Jeff asked me to do this about a week ago, I paused for a minute because it's tax time and our grades are due tomorrow and I've got a pile this high on my desk of things to attend to. But it turned out to be one of the best things that I could do this past week. It was really uplifting to stop and look back at the work of our students over the last, I don't know, 10 years or so. I've been at the high school for about 15 and my colleague Richard Roethlisberger has been there for about 13 years. So this is work that I have images of that I've gathered together from that time. Some of it is based on curriculum and some of it is pictures of our actual facility. So I wanted to give you guys just a picture of what we do and also talk a little bit about how we go at it with the students. So this beginning just talking about Richard and myself. Richard is a working photographer. He's shown in Portland at Radiant Light Gallery and other spots. This is a student who we worked with last year who visited us from Taiwan. She was one of our really strong art students last year, Emily Yang. And we're standing together in front of her work at last year's student art show that goes up in early May every year. This is the famous painting that Jeff just mentioned. This is my kind of pride and joy. I had a painting accepted into the art collection at the Art Museum, and it was up last year in the new acquisitions show during the spring, and it's in their, it will be in their collection forever, and they can show it whenever they want. It's a very small painting, and it was based on something I saw out in Portland Harbor one day. And this is a photograph that Richard took, and I believe he did this when he was on sabbatical in Italy. This is of the Familia Sagrada Church in Italy, or Spain, excuse me. This is from one of Richard's travels. He travels a lot. It's a lovely shot. So here's one of our classrooms, and we've really benefited from the renovation that went on. Our classrooms are so much better now, and we have much more room to move around and can do a lot more variety of projects in our spaces. So Richard's room has extended. He has this room, which is mostly for drawing and painting, and then he has a photo room, and then he has a dark room. So this is his computer station, and one of the things he's looking forward to doing in his program is adding more digital photography, and he's been applying for grants to add to his setup. This is his one computer setup right now, and he's hoping to expand that. And his darkroom, which is equipped for 12 students to work at once, they're 12 enlargers, and he has an average of 15 students in a class. And this is my room. I'm down at the other end of the ground floor of the high school. This used to be an old boat building room, and if any of you had been in it about 10 years ago, it was pretty ratty. It had very funky clapboard lights that someone had practiced shingling on, and rough concrete floor, and I kind of liked it because I could get as messy as I wanted. One of the downsides was I had one sink when I moved in there, and doing ceramics with one sink and 18 students is a trick. So now I have five sinks, and I have a separate area here for the potter's wheels. We have eight potter's wheels, and that's part of every ceramics class. And I have a state-of-the-art kiln room, which is finally safe and well-ventilated and a much better setup than we used to have. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about the curriculum at the high school through pictures and show you the structure of it. We have introductory level classes in photography and ceramics and art fundamentals that anyone can take without a prerequisite. And then we have mid-level classes like drawing and painting and art and culture that students need a little background for. And then we have advanced classes in ceramics and advanced art studio, which is an advanced drawing and painting class, and advanced photography. And this is a piece by Ariana Belcher that won the Cape Arts Commission Purchase Prize a couple years ago and is part of our permanent collection. Here's another photograph of poker chips. Richard always does a piece on movement in photography. And this is by Tucker Emerson, and this year this was one of the Gold Key Award winners at the Scholastic Art Show, which is sponsored by Maine College of Art. This is a national show that is held in every state. and schools from all over the state compete. The teachers choose who's going to enter. We each can choose 3 students. And we put our work up, and Mecca has judges come in and select the awards. And then all the gold key awards from each state go on to the national level. And that's where Chloe Brown got her silver prize from. So Tucker is an athlete. And I heard him describing his relationship to history and politics to Mr. Ely recently. And he wasn't at all interested. But this is a wonderful photograph, so there's great depth in him, which I love seeing. I'm not sure who this is by. Richard sent me several images from his classes. This is Chloe Brown's self-portrait, kind of a rough photograph of it, but it was a box that contained a lot of images that she had shot and that spread out into sort of an installation. Chloe is a junior this year and one of our really strong art students. Okay, so here's an introductory level class. This is Jack Fisher, a freshman. And when I told him I was shooting him for the school board, he perked right up. We're working on a painting project. This is shot just last week. And I thought I'd just walk you through the steps of an art project to see what we do and why we like to really develop things over time with our students. So we started in this project doing some formal color studies, looking at how to mix color and apply paint on a page to create light. Then we went for a field trip to the IGA. It's a great photograph, a little bit out of focus, but we went up to the IGA after looking at Janet Fish's photograph. She's a contemporary still life painter, primarily. And the students shot things all over the IGA during one period. We had a really fast trip with a lot of digital cameras. And they were shooting vegetables and displays of meat and things like that. And then we brought the images back, and we had a quick lesson in Photoshop in adjusting and manipulating images on one of our banks of laptops, which was one of the first times I've dealt with laptops with a whole class of students. So I'm learning how to do that. It's an interesting process. And here they are. They've worked, cropped their images. They've selected them, and they're working from them using acrylic paints. This is Matt Rand and Sean Campbell. And Sean actually works at the IGA, so it was a nice loop. And these are some of their paintings in process here. They're sort of photorealist. They're very tight, but they're really interesting in terms of color and development. Okay, drawing and painting is the next course that students would go on to from Art Fundamentals if they were interested in doing more in that area. This is a piece by Zach Nedwell a couple of years ago, and this is one that's in our permanent art collection that his portrait is across from the office, and Joanne and Jean say that he's always looking at them, keeping them on their guard. It's done with fingerprints. The entire thing is stamp pad and fingerprints, and it's based on a contemporary artist named Chuck Close, who does really huge portraits. So with this class, I've always done a lot of work with portraits as a start-in. It's just a semester class, so we focus on drawing around one theme, which is portraiture. And the students start by doing a bunch of exercises and then doing some photography. They shoot each other. And then this year, again, we were using laptops and adjusting the photographs and cropping them. So this is Alyssa Jones, one of my students right now, who's very interested in art. She's a sophomore. And going from that photograph that I took of her there, she's developing the drawing, and now she's working into it with collage using paper that she toned. Here's Stephanie House, who's a sophomore right now, who's in my painting and drawing class. And again, this is showing development of an image. This was about a week and a half ago. And here she is now. And she's still working into it. She's got another week or so to go. So it's a very large piece. These are about 22 by 30 inches. And this is Daley Gruen, who was just here, so from last year's class. Daley is very gifted in art as well, and Miwa Jerkowitz from several years ago. And this is also in our permanent art collection. Okay, in painting and drawing, we do a lot of observational work from still lifes and landscape. We try to get out as much as possible. If I can take a trip every semester to the art museum, that's always a great add-on. So here we are. Last year, this is Gary Dershowitz, was in the painting and drawing class, and we were on a day trip, on an hour-long trip to the art museum, and Gary was drawing in our class last year. it's wonderful having the art museum so close. We try to use it as much as possible. And also go to the galleries and see what's going on and try and go to the gallery where I show and talk to the director so they can meet and see what's happening out in the world. And just last summer, Amelia Wiggins, who was one of my students, was an intern at my gallery and worked there while she's at college. So advanced art is taking drawing and painting further and doing some 3D work. This is from Richard's class right now. This is, believe it or not, a self-portrait done, I think, by Heather. I'm not sure. It's by one of his students, done with mat board, all built up. And jumping back a few years in time, this is one of my advanced classes doing portrait painting using oils. And I popped this slide in because most of these students went on in art. Zach Nedwell went to Orono, and I believe he was majoring in art last I talked to him. And Erica Legg went to UConn and majored in art. Haley Griffin is at Maryland Institute College of Art, and she just had an illustration put in the New York Times op-ed page recently, which was wonderful. And Roxy Kenny behind there was looking at Savannah College of Art. I think we send 5 to 10 students to art colleges or art majors every year, which is a really wonderful proportion from a school our size. And they do well. Oops. Sorry. So these were two paintings that came out of that class, both of Megan Clark, by two different students. Richard does a lot of work with the skeleton. This is from his class this year. Two different students. This is by Ashelle Gregory, who's a senior this year. Really wonderful draftsman. And Richard did a project this fall, which was a gift to orphans, and I think it was in Guatemala. I wasn't on this fall, so I didn't follow it. But the students did portraits of kids from photographs that were sent to them, and then the portraits were sent back to the kids to become part of their own sort of private collection of treasures. So that was the previous one. It was by Megan McClavick, and this is by Ashelle Gregory. Some more of their relief sculptures. And this is, Ashelle is doing an independent study in portrait painting right now. And this is a painting of her great-grandmother. She's going to do a sequence of portraits of her great-grandmother, her grandmother, her mother, and herself. And a painting she did last year of Reese Ainsworth that's part of a mural project that's going to be installed in the school. And this also won a Gold Key Award at Mecca. She's really good. If I could have painted like this when I was in high school, I could have retired. Why now? Okay, ceramics is a big part of the school, and we've been joking a lot this year. I think the kids think of it as ceramics therapy class because they get to come in the middle of a very intense and stressful day and just work with their hands, make things that they can use, and they love it. It's always a class that students are happy in. They move around a lot, there's a fair amount of socializing, and their work is really beautiful as well. So this is Whitney Turkanis a few years ago. And some of our introductory ceramics work based on organic forms. This is by Erin LaPointe, graduated a few years ago. And right now I have a really active advanced ceramics class. This is Jamie Anthony, and she's laying out slabs for a lamp base project. So the slabs will stack up into a finished piece. And Nate Hansen, again, building a lamp base and starting to think about wiring it. Nate's going on in engineering, and he was the first one to figure out how to take apart the light structure that I got there and rebuild it so it would work. And a beginning student this year, Nolan Sullivan. This is a hand-built piece. David Gardner did this a few years ago. It's called Birkenkrock, and it was actually from a sculpture class. I love it. And Jeff picked it, I think, to be part of the permanent art collection. We have it on display. This is Abhijit working on the wheel. Kids get very good on the wheel by the time they're in advanced ceramics, and that's always fun to watch. And Lily Wenberg, Rosie's sister. Lily's going to do another advanced ceramics program next year, independent study. This is by Calvin Klopp. I put in a bunch of these teapots because they're in a teapot show right now at Portland Pottery that's up for about a week. I took about 6 pieces up for that in top view. We have a sculpture class. We have a bunch of classes that we offer every other year just to flesh out our program. One of them is sculpture, and this I had about 2 years ago, and we did a section on stone carving. This is Abby Terrio working on her stone carving project. And a piece by Megan Clark that was brought into the permanent art collection. Art and culture is another one of these classes that we add on, and that's a hands-on art history course where we're studying art from different parts of the world and different time periods, and then doing projects based on the styles of art we're learning about, and talking a lot about the philosophy of art, why a culture does art, and what the art is for, how it functions. So this is Aboriginal Australian paintings based on their dream culture, and for my students, based on their own dreams. This was a painting by Nate Shannon, who graduated a couple years ago. This is Eric Sprague when he was young. He's all grown up now. He was doing one on, about surfing, going out to the ocean using Aboriginal style. We've done things on Pueblo pots and medieval manuscripts, Japanese tie-dyeing, all sorts of different cultural traditions. And it's a fun class for me because every year I bring in something new depending on what I'm interested in and what's on view in Portland. We did graffiti, a section on graffiti art last year after talking about cave painting. So we were looking at Lascaux cave paintings and thinking about why people first started to make art and comparing it to why people go out in the dark and paint graffiti on walls. I had some graffiti artists in the class, so I had some experts, I'm afraid. The annual art exhibit is a big thing every year. We have the entire downstairs area by the theater set up with our show. We keep it up for about a week, and we have purchase prizes that are brought in by the Cape Arts Commission that started a number of years ago that have been a really wonderful addition to the program. So the students get excited, and they get their work ready, and they help us hang it, and it's a great moment. This is Amelia Wiggins several years ago. She was standing with her senior portfolio of work, and Amelia went off from Cape to Maryland Institute College of Art, and we've stayed in touch. I've seen a fair amount of her. She's been in France this year studying art and has just had a wonderful time in her program. She's also very, very talented. This is Richard with Ben Salerno last year's show. Ben is one of our seniors right now, and he's looking at going on in digital animation. So he's more focused on the gaming side of being an artist. And there's Chloe Brown and her mom. Her mom was one of the judges last year for the Arts Commission Awards. And Mr. Ehlers, Gene Ehlers, and who was the host dad for Emily Yang, our student last year. Some several years back, a couple of our award winners. I like it that they come from all parts of the spectrum of the high school. It's not just the art kids. Sometimes kids who are more into athletics, more into different areas of the school, do very well in the arts. This is Whitney Legg and her friend Matt. Matt posed for the photograph that they're holding there, and that's also in our permanent art collection. And just looking around the school a little bit, when you guys walk into the high school, in the entryway there's always a display on the wall. And these are the pieces that we've acquired over the years and framed and are keeping. Once the school was renovated and we had a chance to reinstall the work, it was really nice to have such bright, well-lit spaces and clean walls to put things up on. And the case in the center was for 3D work that was acquired by the Art Awards. And just to finish, here's one more piece by Amelia Wiggins. This was done in Art and Culture, and it was about the idea about inspiration. We were doing masks based on African culture. We'd been up to the African Tribal Arts Museum in Portland and looked at a lot of images. And that was her sort of self-explanation of what it's like to be an artist. So I wanted to put that up there. We have a really wonderful program. It's very rich. It reaches a lot of kids. Between Richard and myself, I think we teach about 285 kids a year through the art program. So that's about half the student body is touching some aspect of the arts at the high school. And again, many of our kids just touch art in high school, and that's enough. They get a taste of it. But an awful lot of kids go on, and they do something in the arts later, whether it's just something for their own pleasure or professionally. There are so many careers now that are exploring different aspects of the art, either fine arts or technological approaches to art. And we really feel like we give them a strong foundation, very formal foundation in the arts, and they take it with them and they run with it. So thank you for taking the time to look at all this with me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was uplifting and inspiring, and your timing is perfect right before we discussed budget. So it's a nice glimpse into the art world over at CAPE, and I had no idea, and that was just really exciting to see.
Thank you. Thanks. I thought I might be the light relief for the evening.
I guess we'll move along then. Policies for second reading.
I got to shift out of art into policies.
Yes, no. It's a little hard.
Yeah. I think I need a potter's wheel.
Yes. I think we all need a potter's wheel.
These are policies for second reading, so I need a motion.
Right? Yes.
I'd like to move that the board approve policy BBAB, Student School Board Representative, in the supporting guidelines, BBAB-R, Student School Board Representative, policy guideline as presented.
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Discussions? Comments? No. Okay. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
I'd like to move that we approve policy ECB and its supporting guidelines, ECBR, which deal with the integrated pest management and the administrative procedures.
Thank you.
I'll second that if you're not talking about me.
Thank you, Kevin.
We didn't define pest in the policy.
Another little lighting. Discussion, comments, questions? All in favor? 7-0. Next one.
I would like to move that we eliminate policy ECE, traffic and parking controls, based on the recommendation of the policy committee as presented here.
Is there a second?
Second.
Linda? Discussion, questions? Was that a discussion, a question, or just a hand in the air?
Yes, I hope I have the answer, so.
I wasn't sure what that was.
I'm just going to throw out the question. I don't want this to be a big deal. Can we just delete the middle paragraph? I still think it's worthwhile saying that people are on the school property as privilege granted by the district or the boards, and that the assignment of parking areas to staff will be the responsibility of the school administration. I still believe that's within the purview of the schools. It's not an issue of traffic management by the town. So I'm wondering, do we have to throw out the baby and the bathwater, or can we just throw out the bathwater?
Other comments? Do you want to amend your motion?
I don't know, because we did talk about driving and parking on school property. Are they technically privileges granted by the board versus the town?
Well, does the town manage the parking lot, or do we?
The town posts the signs. And they are the ones technically that can police and ticket for violations of parking. The school cannot. They post, it is the school, the police, that if people at the pickup circle are parked incorrectly, that can ticket. They're the ones that post the no parking.
Okay, so how about just that last paragraph then?
So you want to keep the assignment of parking areas to staff, students, and visitors to the school shall be the responsibility of the school administration?
Yeah.
That makes sense to me. I mean, as opposed to whose responsibility would that be if it wasn't the school administration?
Is that something, though, that requires a policy and not just something that would be in the high school handbook?
Which it is, actually. It is in the high school handbook. This is what we struggled with. We hear you, it is. I mean, it's really handled by the high school administration. The information is in the high school handbook. Does the board need to be involved? Do we need a policy that the administrators feel that they need to fall back on? Or does this say what's already happening? It's in the handbooks. That was what we struggled with. We did talk about this, so it's...
This is taking more time than I wanted, but I'll just say, do policies generally guide what goes in handbooks?
They should.
So shouldn't we have a policy to help guide what goes in the handbook?
Okay, I amend the policy. Can I do that?
Yes, you can.
Okay, I amend my motion to retain the traffic and parking controls policy and to have it read only the last paragraph, which says the assignment of parking areas to staff, students, and visitors to the school shall be the responsibility of the school administration. The roadways on the school property will be posted and policed in accordance with local town ordinances.
Yeah. Is there a second for the amended
second.
Motion? Okay. Any further discussion?
I'm sorry.
All in favor? Opposed? 6-1.
Okay.
Moving on.
Policy IKFC, awarding of high school credit prior to grade 9. I move that we approve this as presented.
Second.
Oh, thank you. All right. Discussion. I apologize for not remembering. Is this a change to what we have?
No. It clarified. There was a clarifying statement that was added. There was no challenges at the first reading, so it has not changed since the first reading. We discussed it because I think the issue was we didn't want to preclude students who could graduate early, but this wasn't the case because of, we added a clarification that specified who a high school student was, and it was to say that until they were taking courses in the fall of his or her ninth grade year, they weren't considered high school students. So all we did was clarify what that meant.
Okay.
But there hasn't been any change since the first reading.
Other questions, comments? No. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Okay. Thank you, Trish. New business, consideration of superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee positions, spring 2007. Alan?
First page of this is from Keith Weatherby, the athletic administrator at Keith Elizabeth High School. It is one returning coach, Kurt Chapin, who is assistant varsity girls lacrosse. He is a volunteer and is at a level 3. And remember, we can't volunteer if we do not pay them.
Do you want to take that as an individual, or do you want to take
it? I do, because I got to change the next page.
Okay. All right. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation.
A second?
Second.
Linda? Discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
Now, the next page, what I need to do is we received an email from Scott Labby this morning, and you have in front of you coaching positions at the middle school, but there was a couple of mistakes in it. So I'm going to pass on to you the revised edition to that. As Scott writes, attached, please find a new spring coaches nomination sheet for tomorrow's meeting. Two coaches were deleted from my original list. They are Christopher Drake and Anna Lombard. They have decided not to coach, and additions to the list are Kim Sturgeon, Rachel McDonald, and Ben Dyer. So if you go to the next page, what it is the new coaching positions. I want to be clear with this, just so that it is not considered that these are new positions that have been created. These are the same positions, it's just different coaches in those positions. First one is Paul Casey, his eighth grade track. He'll do 126 hours in a level three. Kim Sturgeon, seventh grade track, 126 hours at a level three. Ryan Foley, eighth grade boys lacrosse, 144 hours at level one. Joel Schroeder, seventh grade lacrosse, 144 hours at a level three. Mariah Nelson, eighth grade girls lacrosse, 144 hours, level one. Rachel McDonald, seventh grade lacrosse, 144 hours, level one. Ben Dyer, boys expansion baseball, 126 hours, level three. And you'll note under each one of those, there is a brief description of what they'll be doing. I didn't read that to you at this time.
Is there a motion?
I move we accept the superintendent's recommendation for middle school coaching positions.
Thank you, Kevin. Second. Trish, discussion, questions? Seeing none, all in favor?
I'm sorry,
I missed the left group. Opposed? 7-0. I was looking right when I should have been looking left. Okay. Consideration of policies for first reading. Trish?
The first policy is DFD, which is gate receipts at admissions. And I'm not making a motion, I'm just presenting them tonight for first reading.
Do you want to just give a brief?
The only changes we made, this is an existing policy. This is a brand new policy. From the extracurriculum committee has reviewed this. It's a brand new policy to deal with the gate receipts issue that came up sort of related to the turf field. And it sort of clarifies what events admissions can be charged at, school-sponsored events. We put that in there. And that the admission will be based on recommendations of the superintendent. Comments, questions? Forward them to the policy if they come up after that, prior to our second reading. Another new policy, FF, which is the naming of school facilities. This sort of all came up as well during the turf and the sort of signage we spoke about earlier today with the boosters, or earlier this evening. This sort of lays out the policy and the guidelines. What the process is for requesting that a portion of the school build the property or the school itself is named, and who has the final approval. The document that you have does reflect and incorporate input from the town manager and information from other districts who have policies of this nature. Policy JICB, which is care of school property by students. We did revise this. It reflects, Drummond and Woodsum did not have any specific comments, just to really update this. One of their comments that they suggested was that we address, update it for laptops. The laptops are actually technically owned by the state, and there's a separate policy in our book, IGNDB, which deals with student computer use and addresses laptops in there. So we've sort of cleaned this up and clarified it based on policy discussion and, I guess, technically Drummond Woodsum review.
I have a couple, I'm not sure this is a question, but we've titled it Care of School Property by Students, but yet inside we reference teachers. More than just students, so I was thinking of maybe renaming it Care of School Property.
Yep.
And in keeping with what we do with the other guidelines, the guidelines, should they not be named the same, care of school property guidelines versus non-return of school property, so that it's clear that those are the guidelines that are, they're named the same as we do with the rest of the book?
So noted, and we'll talk about that. I think they're good suggestions. We'll confirm that at policy. And the last one
is policy JJIBC, which is sort of a redo of an existing policy with extensive, I think you got a copy that showed the red revisions. The revisions, the extracurricular committee spent a lot of time looking at this, and much of the revision is based on MSMA recommendations. They spent a lot of time on these policies.
I have just one question on that one. In the third paragraph down, booster organization coordinating committee, the superintendent shall organize an extracurricular booster organization coordinating committee. The committee may consist of, I'm just curious why may instead of will. What type of flexibility are they wanting with having it be may instead of will? Can one of those people, are all of them important to the process, or would that end up becoming just one of them? I'm just trying to get a sense.
I think we wanted to address, for example, the music boosters does not have a coach.
Okay.
So just sort of depending on what the booster organization was, what their makeup and representation should be, or could be, I guess, okay, is a better way to put it.
I had a question. And I think I brought this up before, but I had to think about it a little farther. On page 2, number 11, booster organizations will not directly pay coaches or officials. When I first read it, I was confused because to me it said that they would not be responsible for the pay. But what it's really saying is they don't pay them directly. It does go through our system. So I'm wondering if we should add something that clarifies that, and I'm not very good at writing this, but I was thinking something along like this payment will be deposited and handled by the business office. I just want to make sure that we're clear that they are paying them, but indirectly through us, because it struck me that when it says they will not directly pay coaches or officials, it sort of meant to me that they weren't paying them at all, but yet they are.
Okay.
Just a suggestion.
Okay.
Take it or leave it. And the other thing was, I was wondering if we should have, and I know this isn't a guideline, but I'm wondering if we should have a copy of the form for the annual statement attached to this policy. And maybe, I know it's not a guideline, and maybe that's inappropriate, but I know we have that form. And so if somebody were to look up this policy, say online once it's approved, having that form would be a good way for them to access it and, you know, not be calling around looking for it.
The reporting form, you mean?
The reporting form, yes. The one that Pauline, I think, developed per our request a couple years ago.
Okay. Thank you. I think that's it.
That's it for that? Okay.
Question, but not a change on that same policy.
Mm-hmm.
Now that it's reached the first reading level, will we be distributing copies of the draft to the booster groups through the athletic director?
Good question.
I think it would be appropriate to have them take a look at it, and if there are any issues with the policy, raise those issues now rather than after we've accepted the policy is. Because then it will take us a minimum of 2 months, if a good point is raised, to change the policy.
I can tell you that we did have a representative from the boosters at our extracurricular meetings.
Yes,
while we were writing the policy.
And I'm just thinking in terms of, I recognize who that person is and the great work they do, but that still leaves out every other booster group, unless there's some sort of line of communication between that booster group and all the others, and I, based on what I understand, I think that's kind of unlikely. So using Keith as a conduit, I just think it's in our own best interest and everybody else's as well, to make sure that the subjects of the policy see what the policy has to say.
Okay. Thank you very much, Trish.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, are we through with that?
Are there any other comments and questions?
Actually, yes, I'm sorry. And on the one where it says the committee shall meet no more than 3 times per year to assure compliance with the school board policy, you eliminated at least 3 times.
Yes.
Doesn't that mean that you're leaving the door open that they don't have to meet at all for during the year with that language? Isn't that something you suggested, Aaron?
No. I think what we looked at was, it originally said we would meet 3 times per year.
Mm-hmm.
The sense was that was too many times.
Mm-hmm.
So it leaves it open, would either be 1 or 2 a year. And I think the direction will be to a year, and it'll be up to the superintendent to call those.
I think Karen...
She does raise a good point, though. Maybe it needs to say at least once, but no more.
More than three?
Yeah.
Yep, it's fine.
This is the beauty of these discussions, when we spend a long time in this policy to the point you need a fresh set of eyes, so this is good process.
That's why it was good to have the first copy, the amended copy, and, you know, the different colors, because it helped tell you where it was going.
Yeah, a new color.
Yeah, we need a new color. We can have a vote on what the new color's going to be. Thank you very much, Trish, and thank you for meeting twice this past month to try to put through policies that were on the burner that people felt were important to get put together. Okay. Consideration of proposed school calendar for 2007-2008. Trish again.
First, I want to thank the committee members who met several times. Debbie Butterworth, Kathy Walsh, Troy Henninger, Dwight Ely, Steve Conley, Shari Robinson, and Mary Bruns. And thanks to the parents who also sent thoughts and suggestions. I guess I make a motion to accept the draft calendar as presented for the school year 2007-2008.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Discussions, comments?
Just had a question on the early release days. Was there any discussion as far as minimizing or reducing the number of?
We did. I think we took out two. There was lots of discussion around the early release day, probably about it's valuable to teachers in terms of the time, but actually we did cut out two because there was also a concern from parents and teachers as well that they are sort of a disruption. They sort of break up the week. We looked at moving them to other days, had pros and cons to that, but there are two fewer. I believe there's two fewer early release days than there were last year.
And I think there was also a discussion, if I'm right, about moving a couple of early release days to a Friday. Mm-hmm. One was before a long weekend. And it's interesting because I was stopped today by a parent saying, why don't you have early release days on before a weekend or before a vacation? I said, could you mention that? We're trying to, you know, make those changes. Again, we're trying to be sensitive to parents, you know, who might have plans, who might be leaving early on a weekend or a long weekend or a vacation or something. So there was a little change there. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. And if we didn't have Mary at these meetings, I don't know what we would do.
True.
So the consensus of the committee was that it makes sense to put some of these early release days on the Friday.
We only did one, which was before Memorial Day. All the rest remain on Wednesdays, and there were a couple reasons.
In June. There's one in June.
That's the last day of school.
Right. Okay.
Which is traditionally an early release.
Okay. It'll be interesting to see what happens, because obviously what comes to my mind is,
skip the morning.
You know, they'll skip the whole day.
Which is why we didn't. That was one of the arguments against moving them all to Fridays.
Yeah.
There were some parents that said, please leave them on Wednesdays. I've reworked my work schedule. If you do an early release on another day, it makes it difficult. Yeah. And there were pros and cons to moving it, but it sort of, we came down on sort of leaving it where it was.
It'll be interesting to see.
Further discussion? Questions? Anybody want to glare at it a few more times? No? Okay. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
Is this the appropriate time to just mention that the calendar committee is meeting again?
Yes.
We are meeting again, and I thank the committee members for their willingness to do this, even though this has been accepted, to do a little long-range planning and look at this calendar for the year 07-08, so that we have time to digest and plan if there are cost and schedule implications for some of the ideas that the committee members talked about. And that is Monday, April 23rd, I believe. So if any of the board members or the public have suggestions and thoughts, hopefully we would have time to digest them and do what we could to accommodate those. So please forward them to me, I guess.
Thank you.
Thank you, Trish. Moving to consideration of job descriptions from the Personnel Committee. Linda?
At our last Personnel Committee, Dominic DePazzi came in with two additional job descriptions from his area, one being the certified school psychologist, the second being the certified school psychological service provider. And at this time, I'd like to make a motion for acceptance of the job descriptions as presented.
Second. Thank you, Rebecca. Discussion, questions? Did you have a question? Okay. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Great. Consideration of superintendent's proposed budget for fiscal year 2008. Kevin?
I have to read this.
Okay.
I move the Cape Elizabeth School Board adopt the 2007-2008 budget in the amount of $18,901,089, a total of $656,795, or 3.6%, which represents a 2.45 increase on the taxes generated by school support. And further charge the superintendent and district leadership team to adjust the difference of $124,061, version 3, with adjusting the difference in accordance with sound educational policy and practice, and with consideration for class size issues.
I'll second.
Linda? I'm sorry, you said you second?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We may
I'm
have
sorry,
to have...
I'm sorry, who seconded?
Linda did.
Thank you.
You do have that in writing, right? So that we have to refer back to it. We can refer back to it
yes,
a couple times. Okay, thank you. I'm glad you did that because I didn't take notes that fast. Discussion.
Can you walk us through how you got to that, Kevin?
As soon as Alan returns my papers. Hey,
just 1 minute, 120. Okay.
I've listened very carefully to Alan and the district leadership team during our discussions, as well as listening very, very carefully to the individual board members. And I recognize that before I recognize anything, I'm firmly convinced that this board can come to an agreement on a percentage or dollar amount, total dollar amount of increase. However, I equally believe that we have some differences around where those cuts should come from. And I've tried to address that by putting that in the hands of the superintendent and DLT. Of course, taking into consideration some of our thoughts that we've expressed. In my own case, in order to wrap my arms around a number to move forward, I put together a sheet which actually represents my opinion only on where I might come up with the money in order to achieve a 3.6% increase. And once again, while these might be my recommendations, it is not my intention to direct either Alan or the district leadership team specifically. What I've looked at, and there are two items beginning this list that I believe have been acknowledged as positions that are now superfluous, and that is a second grade position. And I'm using the number of $56,000 just as an average for a one FTE, and a kindergarten position of $28,000, which brings us to a total of $84,000. In the middle school, we technically have 2.5 FTE positions that are superfluous. However, I am supporting the B proposal relative to an achievement center, which would require that two of those folks staff that new instructional, the instructional support positions. So that's just one half of a position, which is $28,000. In the high school, I have focused on the issue of class size and teacher load. Teacher load is my operative term in thinking about classes when we have no, you know, that are unlike, for example, those in the first through fourth grade in the early part of middle school. And I firmly believe that that should be a controlling factor. And again, this is my personal opinion. However, I do recognize that there are courses out there brought to our attention by administration that not only have small teacher loads, but have equally small teacher teacher class sizes. Those happen to be, in the case of the high school course in Latin. However, once again, I'm not making any directive on that to the superintendent. It's simply a recommendation for consideration. And then I move into the area of other. And the first other that I feel needs to go is $9,440 in additional police services. That level is untenable and can be served if we need to through police security or stipends. And, private security or stipends. I know the police department won't be happy about it, but I can't imagine paying the kind of rate, which is basically a time and a half for a guaranteed minimum amount of hours. On the turf field replacement, there was an item in there for $7,000. That's pretty much a wash because we have also effectively committed to $7,000 to replace the field in roughly 15 years. And the council has matched that, so that is an add back in on that. And out of district placement, I would like to see that account zeroed and that we look to our reserve of $250,000 to address those issues as they may come down the pike. However, in thinking about it again, I added $50,000 to the contingency fund for exactly the same purpose. So it's really a reduction of reserve being reclassed to contingency. And so far as I'm concerned, if we go beyond contingency and reserve, then it's the town council's job to fill in any deficit there. And professional development, $7,664, which is brings the increase in professional development back to what we actually expended, I believe, 2 years ago, and with the hopes that we'll be able to restore that $7,600 as well as perhaps more in the coming years. That's how I wrap my arms around the number of 3.6%.
How much was the high school Latin?
Well, I'm using $22,400 for Latin and $22,400 for chorus, as they're both 0.4 FTEs. But ultimately, within the 3.6% budget I've suggested, there are funds that permit the superintendent and the district leadership team with some latitude in how they specifically meet that 3.6 number. So again, these are my recommendations. They are not directives, and I'm sure that other people here might come down to a number close to my 3.6, but may consist of entirely other items. That's my explanation.
Thank you, Kevin. Somebody else like to go next?
I'm not sure how.
I mean, if nobody wants to say anything, we can vote. Just kidding. Would you like to say something?
I appreciate the information that Kevin's provided us. I guess I went at this looking at the different issues that the superintendent had identified for us when he presented a budget that was at a 4.2% increase. And there were certain areas that he presented to us that we needed to look at. Again, I don't think there are some areas that I disagree with Kevin on and some areas that I would do differently. I guess if it's appropriate, I guess the only comment I would like to make, I don't know if I should do this or if we should just vote. I guess I wanted to talk a little bit about the high school, and I don't know if it's appropriate to do that.
Sure. I don't see why not.
Okay. I guess I there's a couple things that I think are telling at the high school. I have some concerns. Again, when we come up with this number, we're not necessarily per se directing cuts in any particular area. I feel strongly, however, that the high school is not one that I personally would suggest cuts at for a couple reasons. We heard early tonight, and we've heard it before, that this year is the most competitive year for college applications. That's not going to change for several years. We need to prepare our kids for that. We do not have, I wish our course selection book was as big as our policy manual, but it's not. Our kids don't have a lot of electives. The reality is if we cut some of them, our class sizes are only kept to a certain level. They'll end up in study halls, which is a waste. Our class sizes at the high school, on average, I don't want to get into scheduling, are higher than the national average. The national average is 15 kids. We're at 16.9. PSAT scores, I sort of took a look at that. Our PSAT scores this year compared to the past 5 years are down, except with the exception of reading. Our budgets over the past 3 years or 4 years have been pretty much stable. I think we're starting to see that stable isn't getting us anywhere. So I have some real concerns about cutting right now.
Do you have an alternate number?
Do you want to vote on the existing motion?
I don't know.
He might amend if you can convince him.
I would just leave the high school the way it is because of those. I understand that there are smaller courses, but by the same token, we've heard at a math presentation that there are math classes, 23, 24, 25 kids, which is why I was focusing on average. I'm not scheduling. I don't admit to understanding the scheduling. We've also heard at least 65 or higher, close to 70% of our classes based on distributions are 16 kids or higher. The majority of our classes are higher than the national average of class size. We have heard that many of the classes are small for educational reasons. So those are based on educational needs. I also think that because of the competition in college applications, our kids are competing against kids, I would say nationally and globally, but at least in New England for those spots. They're competing against kids from Massachusetts. They're competing against kids from Connecticut. Many of those schools have larger catalogs, course selections. Many of them are larger. They have different resources. Their facilities are bigger and arguably better than ours. We need to have some advantage for our kids. And if a class size of 17, which is still higher than the national average, is our advantage, I feel that if we can maintain that, we've got to do that for our students.
Trish, just to reiterate, it may be to be easier if I just ran down the big numbers. We started off with an 06-07 budget of $18,244,294. When I took out everything that I mentioned and added that one item back in, that brought our adjusted increase down to $563,377. even, which is a rate of increase of 3.09%. At that point, I added $50,000 to contingency, and if it's Allen's and the DLT's choice to call that out-of-district placement, that's their choice. But actually, effectively, I've restored that amount. And then the last amount I restored was $44,800, which just happens to be the two positions in question, which brings my number to roughly 3.6%. So as I said, I was trying to build in flexibility for all of us, but I do hear you, and if that idea has support, I think you might find me amenable to an adjustment to the amendment.
I'd like to hear what other folks have to say. Give people other people a chance to speak.
I would like to support what Trish is saying. I was very much viewing it from weighing more heavily on the teacher load, and I think a lot of what she said is also good reason to maintain what we have going on in the high school as it currently exists, especially in light of increase in population, even though it's 6 students. When that begins to decrease, I think we should reevaluate, but we're not at that point quite yet. I would also like to add, and I understand, I feel like there's been some confusion about the 2.5 being superfluous in the middle school, because if we are even considering a cut based on decrease enrollment in the middle school, my understanding is that that would be guided by school board guidelines. So a decrease in population of 20 students, let's say, might represent a decrease in a teacher of 1. Is it? And yet, well, first of all, I would argue that that might make sense in an elementary school context, if you're talking about a decrease of 20 students in the example of second grade or in kindergarten because they're self-contained classes. But in a middle school context, especially in 7th and 8th, and my understanding is most of the decrease in population is taking place in 8th grade, how that's dispersed out is not necessarily, you cannot necessarily equate with one teacher and just get rid of it and not have it impact other things in a negative way. So first of all, I think that, and I'd like some clarification from you, Alan, on this, why that 2.5 was ever presented as being superfluous when I think really the highest it could have been presented as is 1 because of the decrease in enrollment. So I would just like some clarification on that, where that 2.5 came from, that could even be something, that even would be something that we'd be considering to cut.
I think what you're asking me, I think I can answer it correctly, is at 2.5 is looking at population, realigning population in the school, knowing that we would like to do a large amount of work in improving instructional model. If we could move that 2.5 out and improve the instructional model we're looking at and still have classes that are workable. We won't have classes like Trish was talking about of 15 or 16. We'll have classes of 19 and or 20.
I'd also like to add, Karen, for clarification, I didn't take out 2.5 teachers.
Right.
My discipline is such that I remove the 2.5 teachers as being superfluous in terms of proposal 1, which is just realigning, as Alan just explained, but then I add back 2 of them to staff the proposal B position that I believe I heard consensus on.
So is the actual cut then to the middle school a 0.5?
That's it, 0.5.
Okay, and is that taking into consideration what I heard as a need for RTI support of a 0.5? Because my understanding is that it would be 2 full-time instructional staff, or not in support, or academic leader, or whatever we, however we defined it, is incorporated into that 0.5 RTI that we had thought was important?
If there is a 0.5 support person in the budget, I haven't touched that person.
Okay. And then I would like to make just one more thing that stood out, and I might be the only one who feels this way, But I understand if you go by our school board guidelines that there is good cause to eliminate a second grade position. I guess to me, I feel in early learning, I'm going to give you some reasoning behind why I feel this way, that kindergarten, first, and second grade should be kept at a smaller size. And I've mentioned to a couple of you and sent you all emails on Project STAR about, I'm just going to read this because it sort of sums up what I'd like to say. Findings from the current major well-designed class-side studies, including the one I've mentioned, Project STAR, seem to have influenced policymakers toward the institution of reduced class size. Ernest L. Boyer, president of the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching, has laid out a 4-point plan to ensure that all children are educated to their full potential, which includes reducing classes to no more than 15 students per teacher for the early elementary grades. In addition, the National Association of Elementary School Principals, the NAESP Delegate Assembly, has revised their class size policy statement from 20 to 1 down to recommending a student-teacher ratio of 15 to 1. So I understand that those are not our current guidelines, and I would hope, if not now, in the future, we at least re-examine our guidelines specifically for kindergarten, first, and second grade to reflect perhaps good, well-designed class-side studies. There's so little of that done in the education world, and when it's done, and it's done right, and it's done well, and it has, and it's meaningful, I would like to be mindful of that. So I am not comfortable cutting a second grade position. I think the teachers can do a much better job, especially when they are focused on early intervention, helping children read and do other very time-intensive things. I would be more comfortable with a class size of 15 or 16, and I think my understanding is that if we kept the amount of teachers that there are now, it would be 16 per class, and by getting rid of one, it's 19 per class, and my recommendation or my opinion is that that's too big.
Karen, I don't disagree with you, and I hope that through the adjustments to the agenda that I offered, that I'll be addressing that very question for you later on tonight. And that's all I can, you know, I don't want to draw away attention from this conversation.
I think it's good that we're having this conversation, because I would also like to hear what everyone else is thinking on different items.
Next.
There are a couple things that haven't been mentioned that in my review of the budget after our workshop sessions took place, there were a couple items that seemed to become key areas that haven't been mentioned so far that again, I just want to weigh in my opinion on. One of them is to expand our technology staff to include some instructional support to our teachers and support staff in terms of a technology integrator. There was some discussion on that at a couple of our sessions, and I, again, just one of those points that I would like to put forth. I would like to voice my concern over the proposed athletic budget, and I do think we need to look at considering reducing the proposed budget to exclude those expenses that are directly related to the turf field. We did make a commitment to them on an annual basis to make a contribution to the endowment, and I do believe we ought to live up to that promise. However, there have been several expenses added to the current athletic budget to make up for some of the shortfall in the campaign they've been running to raise funds for the field. And there was also a lot of discussion regarding the boards, or I should say some of us expressed request that you look at the professional development funds and how some of those funds are spent. I'm a firm believer that at least a portion of those funds ought to be targeted to aligning our current technology resources with our curriculum and be targeted directly towards that. But I do support the 3.6. My numbers actually came up a little lower, but I do believe there's room, 3.6 is well within my comfort zone.
Next.
One of the things we haven't discussed yet is I still don't feel this is a balanced budget because of the fact it assumes we're going to accept the state subsidy. They've informally given us a number, but I don't believe it. And I think, in truth, 3 or 4 months down the road, we're going to find out that a lot less money is coming from the state, and therefore, all of our efforts, and I support and respect the comments other board members have made, but I don't think we have any idea how much money is coming from the state. So talking about percentages of taxation and increases in budget, it's not based on true facts as we know them today, because I have no faith in the state of Maine giving us the state subsidy they proposed to us earlier this month. It's just not a true fact, and it's not going to be forthcoming, and I think we have to adjust to that reality and accept it. And that's my position. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I just add one fact? Speaking of facts, and I think that's an interesting point, one thing I did actually look up, because I know that there's probably going to be some question of, you know, what drives sort of our costs and why we have an increase. In the Bureau of Labor Statistics, the state and local government wages for 12 months ended December 2006 were up 4.1%. All categories of labor and civilian private industry were up at least 3%. And I think we should, it's worth noting that 77% of our budget is salaries and benefits, and those costs are going up 4%. I just thought that was worth noting.
Definitely is.
Thank you. excuse me.
Okay. I feel similarly to Trish, and I believe Karen, that with the high school population growing, albeit small number, but it's growing, it's not decreasing, and the existing issues around the number of electives that are available to the students, and the fact that college applications are as competitive as they are, I don't believe that we should be cutting at the high school level. And I think, Karen, I apologize, I don't remember who said it, but that we will be facing a decrease probably in the next year and the years following that. And that is actually, I believe, the appropriate time to make the cuts. I think the numbers are going to be a lot clearer to us as to where there's some flexibility. I have a lot of questions around the proposal that has now been made to us for the middle school in terms of, and I don't know if it's two FTEs or 2.5 FTEs at this point. It's been very confusing over the past couple of days. I do support the concept of providing teacher leaders to help improve instruction, but I would ask that we try to get some more clarification as to exactly how those resources are going to be used. And actually, I would like to, if we can get clarity tonight as to whether is it 2.5 that you're asking for this Plan B? Is it 2? Because I'm not sure.
Yes, please.
What I'm asking you is what I sent to you this afternoon by email as well. On the back of the page, what we did was, after Steve had reviewed all of the population in the school, whether it be distributed, et cetera, what I presented to you is that we are seeking one teacher leader for ELA, one teacher leader for mathematics and science. We've combined that. If you'll note after that, it does talk about what they will be doing, both in their training and the work with the staff. And we also added what is called a scaffolding staff, which is that half-time person would do both RTI, but also ensure that we are offering scaffolding programs for kids who are struggling. In talking with Steve, we talked about is in the one teacher leader for mathematics and science, that person, if that person goes into that position, she would like to continue to teach one science class, just to have the actual physical training with it, so as she works with people to make changes. So if you look under this, what it talks about is what they would do in the spring with the staff in order to do the planning, the summer training that would happen at that point in time, and then the work that would begin in the middle school in the fall with staff in order to make this program work.
Do we currently have a halftime RTI?
Yes. You have what is called a
instructional
support. And so that would actually just remain the same?
You just changed the word.
You just changed the name of that position.
But we're looking at the other half was when we were originally talking about, correct me if I'm wrong, originally talking about the CEF grant, you're talking about moving that position over and the other half would be paid for out of CEF?
Yes, so it would be the full-time response to intervention versus the halftime instructional support program this year.
So Kevin, does that mean in your proposal that you have taken out a certain amount, assuming that CEF will be funding part of this?
So far as I'm concerned, I am not relying on 1 cent of CEF money. They will go through their process. They will make a decision. If they decide in our favor, that will reduce our budget, or it will facilitate other items. But
so then am I correct in understanding that you are accounting for a full 2.5 middle school teachers in your...
No, I'm not. And until I get clarification on exactly what these positions are, I can't do that. My understanding, and I won't say I was led to believe, but my understanding was that if we went with Plan B, of the 2.5 teachers' positions, that administration has acknowledged could have gone otherwise if there was not any plan for the middle school, that we needed two people to staff that new plan. And I just asked just a short time ago if this RTI person that we're talking about is already in the budget, and the answer was yes. So if I'm mistaken, somebody needs to clarify that for me. But that's what I heard, and if that interpretation is correct, then I stand on the two positions. And,
I guess I'd like to add to that. It's my understanding that since we currently have a 0.5 RTI, but we are aiming for a full one RTI, that it would be an additional 0.5 RTI. Is that correct? Yes.
Is that in the budget proposal anyway?
The additional 0.5?
No.
It's in your CEF grant. When you talked about the CEF grant, what we're talking about is we had $144,000 worth of staffing that would be considered for cutting if we didn't get the CEF grant of the support. That was the 2.5 people. If we get the CEF grant, we would get $67,500, which was what was offered in the beginning, which would drop the cost of that 2.5 positions to $77,500. And within that CEF grant would be the money to pay the half of two of the teacher leaders and half of the scaffolding person, which would be then two teacher leaders and one scaffolding person at that point in time.
I think there's been a presumption that the CEF money is going to come in. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not so sure that's a good presumption to make at this point in time. I would like to presume that it's not, and I think there are indications that it probably won't. So I do not want to be banking on that.
Okay, and that's the position I've taken on it, right? Because regardless of anything else, I know that CEF has a process to follow.
Correct.
So nobody has said to you, perhaps I haven't heard it, perhaps it was a meeting I missed, but my understanding was that we only needed two of the 2.5 positions. There was I don't recall there being any formal proposal for the addition of a half person anywhere in the budget. And since the original CEF proposal, for our purposes of conversation, no longer exists, I don't think we shouldn't be relying on that proposal. I'm relying on the proposal that Trish questioned and Alan and Steve came together on. Now, if somebody wants to tell me that we do in fact need that half person, I'm not going to quibble over $22,400, but I just need to hear that.
I agree with what you're saying, is that when we were looking at it, we were looking at two teacher leaders, and we already had a half-time person. If we had got, if we get the CEEF grant, what we'd looked at is adding on to that half person at full-time, and the two teacher leaders would be paid half by CEEF and half by the board. You're absolutely
But that was, the additions were contingent upon receiving CEEF money.
Yep.
And just as we don't know the real amount of state funds coming to us, we don't know whether or not there's CEEF money coming to us. You know, if somebody wants, you know, if the DLT wants to change the proposal, and again, I'm not going to quibble over $22,000. This is, you know.
Can I ask a clarifying question, Kevin, just from your assumptions? Did you didn't mention this, but just out of curiosity, a couple of the other issues that had come up with the nurse issue?
Those were additions, and in conversations and in listening to what Jeff ultimately said to us, we already have effectively 0.33 nurse in there. I would certainly agree to adding 0.12 if we could do that to get a half-time person in there. But if I understood Jeff correctly, and if I understood Alan correctly, they're satisfied that we're meeting the NEASC requirements. And I also believe I heard Jeff say at one of our meetings that we are not jeopardizing any of our students. Is that correct, Jeff? So at this point, well, since we have 0.33, I'd much rather try and find a way. If we, you know, for example, if we have 0.33 person actually supplying medical education, pill dispensing, injections, things like that, part of the position is a bookkeeping function, a record keeping function, and we don't need to pay a nurse's salary for record keeping.
And how about the other question that had come up that was an issue for us to discuss was the math support person at Pond Cove, that being a function of the changing needs of our student population, the large English learning population. Did you account for that at all in your...
If it's in the budget, I haven't touched it. If it's not in the budget...
It's not in there, in your 3.6 estimate, okay. And I don't believe it was in the budget.
It's not.
So that would be... An extra. Okay. Just wanted to clarify. Thank you.
But can, oh, I'm sorry, Rebecca, you had the floor.
Yes. I think I have more of a procedural question. So a number of us have kind of come forward where we were thinking. I think that there are points of consensus. Or general agreement, and there are points where we're all kind of all over the place. Mary, Pauline, and Alan are frantically scribbling away, putting it all down. My question is, if the board votes on a percentage increase without being fairly clear about where some of these changes in the budget are going to be, how will we know as a board, and how will Alan and his district leadership team know where to reflect changes that somehow will represent what's been discussed?
Are you directing your question to anybody in particular?
The board. It's open for people to respond.
Anybody want to?
So I guess maybe then it's, what I would like to try to do is just, I think it's going to be awfully hard for Alan for you to get a sense of how we all feel on this. The other night in one of our workshops, we kind of just went around the room on these various key points and said, were we in support or not? And I think we developed a pretty clear picture as to where the sense of the board was on these particular issues. It wasn't a vote, but it was a sense of the board. And that would perhaps provide some guidance on how to take a percent, a vote on a percent increase or a number to Allen and the DLT. It's not necessarily directive, but yet it will indicate perhaps where the sense of the board is.
One of the reasons why I do like that idea is I think I have spent a lot of time preparing my thoughts on different items, and I would like sharing it like we did the other night, but to the public, and if other people wanted to share certain things, how they felt on different items, I think that would be beneficial to have that as part of public record. I'm throwing it out there. I would not be opposed to doing something similar to what we did at the workshop.
You know, and I've been sitting here listening tonight, and we all have seemed to weigh in on our concerns with this year's budget, some of the items that we want to make sure are covered with the budget, no matter where we may end up with for a percentage, whether it be 3.6 or whatever the percentage may end up to be. I don't see that they're going through item by item is more or less giving a charge to Allen as our financial leader on the day-to-day operations of the school. It does sound like we're looking to go down that road to tell him exactly how the money has to be spent, and I don't feel our role as the board is to do that. I mean, we hired him to do the day-to-day operations, you know, perform the day-to-day operations, and I think him and his leadership team need to take our final decision on what we decide as a board is the bottom line budget number, and let, with our input that he's received so far tonight and through all the budget workshops, and take all that information into consideration as far as when it comes down to a bottom line number, what he's going to have for an annual operating budget. He needs to decide, him and the leadership team, I should say, don't mean to mean leave anybody out of this, need to make the best choices possible for whatever that bottom line balance is for the budget.
Yes, but Linda, you listed some of your concerns that none of us had listed ourselves. So how is, and you're going to be expecting that somehow that's dealt with, as you said, it will be addressed by Allen in his budget. But is that appropriate that if, I mean, how is he to decide that what one person says is what the whole board feels? I mean, perhaps it's just one, and that could be the same thing for me. Perhaps I'm the only one who cares about the nurse. I don't necessarily, but I'm just choosing that. I don't think that that's giving a fair representation to Allen and the DLT. I also would disagree with the characterization of budget building as getting involved in the day-to-day operations. I would call that fiscal oversight. I don't think, I have a great deal of discomfort in saying you need to cut $44,000 and not knowing where that cut's going to come from, especially given some of the information we've heard about what might happen at the high school. There are substantial changes that may occur as a result of that cut that perhaps I would have very strong feelings about. So, you know, if we can't somehow provide some feedback on some of this, we could end up in some places where I could not support the budget, even though I voted on a percentage. And I don't see the logic in that. Why did we spend the hours and the days that we have with an item, line item by line item budget, if we were not to discuss as a board these various areas of our school, of our district? Now, I definitely do not want to be involved in the day-to-day. I think we have excellent administrators, but we are also a board elected by the public to assure public confidence in the way our money, the tax money, is being spent in the schools. If we were only going to be approving a gross sum amount of money, then I suppose that would be the town council's job. But we're not the town council, we're the school board. And there is a level of detail, of responsibility, I believe, that comes with serving as a school board member. So while I don't necessarily want to say you're going to buy 10,000 books for grade two, I think that is involving in the day-to-day operations. But I do think we can give some guidance as to saying we support you in your middle school initiative. We don't support you in the turf field expenses, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Otherwise, why did we have all of these conversations? Thank you.
I haven't weighed in yet, so I guess I'll throw in my two cents worth. And I feel like I'm going to disadvantage because I got a chance to hear what other people said. But it was interesting because I think we all do have a little bit of a different list of things that we might think are important or maybe not as important. And my list actually coincided quite a lot with Kevin's. And although I initially came up with a lower number than his motion, I'm not uncomfortable with the 3.6% increase. I did do a whole bunch of little figuring, but that was my personal figuring, and I guess I see it a little bit differently than Rebecca maybe, but a couple of things that I thought were very important when I looked at it was, one, the decreasing population, and I'm talking district-wide, not individual schools. We've talked about individual schools, and I, you know, have some opinions, but district-wide, our population is decreasing, and it is projected to continue to decrease, at least over the next 5 years. If I'm wrong, Alan, you can tell me I'm wrong. The other thing that came into my mind when I was looking at it was the school consolidation piece. And when I was up in Augusta, it was nice to be able to compare ourselves just mentally with some of our other schools in the state and look at the fact that we were doing some things better and more efficiently, in just my opinion, but for less cost. Now, some people could say, well, you know, that's a great thing, and other people might say that's not a great thing. To me, I thought it was good. And I thought it also gave us a chance, as we move forward with looking at the consolidation piece and how that might play out, and I don't know how it will, but I'd like to think that we could sell ourselves and potentially a plan that we might come up with as a board and as a school district of something that we would be happy with and comfortable with. What I'm seeing coming out of Augusta right now, I'm personally still not too pleased with what I'm seeing, but as it changes on an hourly basis, I'm not going to hang my hat too quickly on anything. I think I share Peter's opinion that state is a fairly confused place and doesn't necessarily know where they're headed themselves. And the third piece I looked at was the town council's pledge of 2.5. And some people might disagree that that should be a factor. It was a factor for me. I'm not saying they're right. I'm not saying they're wrong. I'm just saying it was a factor in how I looked at things. So, but when's all said and done, I am comfortable I would have no problem supporting the motion that Kevin made. With the directive, I think that you tacked on to the end, and we'll probably ask you again to read it in a little bit, Kevin, but that Alan and his staff decide how those monies are spent. Do I think he knows where we stand? Yes, I think he does. Individually and as a group, I think he has heard from us on lots of meetings where different people stand. Can he take care of everything that all seven of us want? No. It's not possible unless all seven of us agree on an item. So he has to make that decision. And in my mind, he and his staff and his district leadership people are the people that we hire to make those decisions. And I'm comfortable with that. So that's my piece. If people want to have additional discussion, we can do that. Otherwise, I think we need to look at the motion and maybe have Kevin read it again and see if we can move on the motion unless there's an amendment.
Let me interject, Kathy.
Yes.
Just in one area, and I don't think that this necessarily constitutes continued debate, but if people are feeling the need to put their components out on the record to the public, which essentially I did when I responded to Rebecca's original question, I don't think that that interferes with the process.
No, not at all.
And if that makes, you know, as I said, and I've said this directly to Alan, and I've said it publicly tonight, that I consider these pieces in that underlie my proposal to be recommendations. And I'll confine myself to that comment at this point.
Well, and I'm glad you restated that, because I probably should have said that just directly too, but I would encourage anybody to say whatever they think is important in this process, whatever they think they want to say about what they think may or may not be important that they would like Alan and his management team to know about. I would not expect that anybody would prevent anybody from saying that, but I'm glad you mentioned that, Kevin, because I'd like to make sure that everyone's encouraged to say what they would like to say.
Alan, can I ask you a question? When we started the budget process, sort of listening to all these things and try to filter it through, when we started the budget process, you presented a budget, but you also identified for us certain areas, some of which have been discussed tonight, that you sort of, the board needed to decide on. The motion right now, whatever it is, whether it's 3.6 higher or lower, wherever we end up, is a number. Do you feel, and your staff, I guess, that you've got the information that you asked us for at the beginning of the process?
I'm going to try to answer this accurately, but follow with me if I need to. When I built the budget, I built a 4.28 budget. I built that budget based on where our system is at this point. Part of the direction to the administrative team was we were to add no new staff. Therefore, as we went through the budget, we had some things that we were very much aware of. Jeff brought the NEAC issue of nursing, and so I added that to this piece at that point in time. The $7,000 to pay for the future of the turf field, I added at that time as something that you need to consider. And I really did that because that was added at the last minute by the town manager, and I felt you needed to have that same consideration. There were the issues, I think, on that list for coaches. And even though Keith had put that in his budget, I took them out. They were new staff, and so I didn't keep them in. So with each of those that I put on, I felt strongly you as a board needed to decide if you wanted to add those or not. I think the issue that has become much clearer to me, remembering that we began this building process in the fall, and at that point in time, I was building a statement based on what we knew of school population at that point in time. Over time, I went to Tom. I said, Tom, you need to go out there and you need to gather every piece of information you need to get. You need to take people by the hand and talk with them clearly. I asked the middle school and the high school to do the same. An issue that I kept hearing from individual board members as well as board members together was a serious concern about there has been an issue over the last few years around staff in schools, whether we have too much staff or what we need. So it became very clear as I heard populations drop, as I watched the population tables drop, that was an issue that I felt the board would be looking at. So that became a piece for me to listen to only. I didn't go in and cut those positions. From the perspective of the middle school, this was the year when the middle school was to give a proposal to CEF. That proposal was done. At the last minute, we realized that proposal was more like the high school, and we really needed more to deal with staff, and so we began to shift that. I recognize the fact we don't have a step-by-step plan for that, and I don't think we will have one until we've met with the middle school staff and done the planning that we need to do. So from the perspective of building that 4.28 budget, what I felt I did was to answer the needs within the schools at that point in time. Obviously, just like you're finding when you're asking me questions that we've talked about before, it is constantly changing because of numbers, because of demands, because of the way we look at things. So I hope that I'm answering your question in that there were things I felt you needed to consider whether you wanted to add or not, and you've gotten some information on that. I think the piece that I'm probably finding the most difficult to deal with is the staff levels. How many staff members we have, how we determine that. Do we use the past policy? Do we relook at it at this point in time, et cetera? As far as the AD position, which is one you've mentioned, several of you have mentioned over and over again, I feel strongly we need to do the $7,000 for the turf. I think you need to take a look at the police coverage. I think you need to take a look at the $7,000 for the pieces on the field that we're going to be paid for also by boosters. I think those are all issues that you need to consider. So for me, the hardest one, for me personally, and the one I'm still not sure on as I've listened to all of you, is what we do about the staffing. And again, I don't feel the board should be naming that I want you to cut this one and this one and this one, as Kevin said, but that I need to get some sense of what do you want to see changing as far as the amount of money for staffing, or do you want it to stay the same? It's a long answer. I hope I hit on some of the points you're asking, Trish. I don't know if there's more questions you want to ask specifically.
Well, no, I'm just wondering then, without making this more lengthy and not taking a straw vote, but to filter in the information and you can do with it what you want, if I will offer what positions I think should be there, or the numbers, you figure them out, is sort of where, again, it's not a directive and it's my opinion. I would cut the staff, the classroom staff, Pond Cove. As policy chair, I will commit to relooking at the class guidelines.
You may not have one of our any choice, meetings.
I would leave the middle school staffing the way it is. You've got a plan, or the numbers that it's at. I would add a half a math support. I like Kevin's idea, at least bring the nursing staff up. At least a half. I actually thought that we should have that in there, but I did add three coaches to athletics. However, manipulating some of the other numbers, the increase in athletics wasn't all that great, but I did support adding those three coaches. And I could spend and expound on all the other things that I would add that we can't do. Listening to those sabbaticals, we're not doing that. Sitting on the calendar committee, we're not adding instructional time. There's lots of things we're not doing, but I will be quiet now. And thank you for answering my question, so I'm hoping now I'm answering yours.
And I would like to go through with what I spent a lot of time on to share with you what I was thinking. I would recommend cutting one of the kindergarten teachers based on the population. I would recommend cutting a 0.5 teacher position in middle school, although I offset that with a recommendation for a 0.5 RTI staff to meet the MS change model. I would recommend cutting the additional professional services for athletics, additional travel expenses, fees for rooms for state championships, and I would support Kevin's idea of out-of-district placement fund. I would keep the same, the second grade teachers. I've already given you, not cutting a second grade teacher, and I've already given you my reasoning. I would definitely maintain the high school teacher load and class sizes for the reasons that Trish presented and also that I added to. I would implement the middle school change model, which does end up being a wash, so there'd be no cuts there. I would maintain current staff development funds proposed in the budget. I would increase the high school nurse to a 0.5, and it sounds like that if it's at a 0.33, we'd just be adding a 0.12. I've already mentioned the increase of the 0.5 RTI. I definitely support the math instructional support person addition of 0.5 in the Pond Cove. Wherever I see glimmers of innovation and support and doing a better job of meeting the needs of students, because I'm not seeing a whole lot of that in this budget, and I find it very discouraging, I'm going to try to support that as much as I can. I would recommend supporting and funding three of the coaching positions for the football, the girls' basketball, and the boys' lacrosse. Understanding we'd be fulfilling our agreement to the football program, and also my belief that athletics is an integral and extremely important part of any child's educational experience. And if there's a demand for in an increase in participation, I'd like to be able to meet that demand. I have some concerns about unmet needs in the high school that were presented by Jeff. Additional science lab time, it didn't appear as though you put a dollar amount with that, but it seems, from what I've read, statistically significant and compelling data has been collected to build a solid case for an increase in science lab time. Specifically, modeling instruction is superior to conventional instruction in the area of physics, and student achievement increases substantially using this instruction model. I believe we should find the time and the money to support this. Same with your request for computer technology and science classes. So I know it was in our budget presentation from you, and yet I never heard any more about it or any dollar amount attached to it, but it was described as an unmet need in the high school, so that's what I'm responding to. I am concerned about the MEA scores that were presented to us, especially in the areas of student exceeds, partially meets, and does not meet for middle school students. So I want to make sure that we're allocating the necessary resources to meet the needs of all of our students, which is why I'd be in support of the math instructional person, the RTI person, anywhere where, once again, we can really zone in and do a better job with students that could use more help and support. I'm concerned about the capital improvement plans. We keep on deferring, and those accounts are building what we need to do in the future. And I'm not so sure that's a smart way to approach it. Technology, I agree with Linda about, I think you mentioned the need for another tech integrator, if that's what you would call it. So I am concerned that we don't have the necessary staff in place, i.e. technology coordinator at each level, full-time certified teacher in the Pond Cove computer lab, which you had also presented. To me, this is a question of looking to the future and being proactive and realistic in the area of staff development and just increase staff if necessary. So I'm also concerned that we are falling farther behind on the equipment replacement schedule. Class size, I think I've sort of referred to why I would like to reevaluate the recommendations, especially in the early elementary years. Student enrollment fluctuations, I would like for us to have a discussion of getting away from, I mean, looking at how enrollment decreases and increases are dispersed throughout each level as opposed to just one sum, because it's a very different scenario depending on the numbers where it's going, what we should do. Bond issue, I'm reading more and more about how other school districts are bonding technology costs. So my question is, why is our district not able to do this while others are? And what do they know that we don't? Meeting the needs of all students. I believe it should be one of our top priorities to fund the necessary resources for early prevention, instructional support, ESL, remedial support at all levels with a relentless eye on addressing issues earlier in the educational process, as well as accelerated courses and diversity of courses to offer educational opportunities that allow all students to reach their potential and find something that they are passionate about, whether or not it's industrial tech program, shop, which we've already cut, and MS, chorus, robotics, photography. I thought that art presentation was phenomenal tonight, creative writing, et cetera. And in the area of language, are we looking to the future, not only whether or not it's Latin, but Chinese, Indian, Arabic, if we want to prepare our students for the future. I think that's the reality, and that's where our future is headed, and I'd like us to be sensitive to that. I do have issues with the school calendar, and I know that would be a cost associated because I'd probably like to increase how much time we spend in school, students and teachers, and unfortunately that would be more expensive. And then collaboration with other surrounding school districts. I think we've done some of that well, and I'd like to do more, and I'd like it to be aimed at cost savings wherever possible while maintaining our educational priorities. We had an excellent example from Gary Lanois on reciprocal agreements for tech development opportunities that I think they've already taken advantage of, and I think that's great, and I think we could probably do a lot more and should spend some time on that. And then athletics, I just have a big picture question of are we spreading ourselves too thin? I'd ask questions about how many programs we had offered 5 years ago, 10 years ago. I've not gotten that information, but I think what we do offer, I think we should do it well and pay our coaches appropriately for the services they're providing, and just to be supportive in a quality manner as we can. So That is my list of how I felt about everything in the budget. And I have a copy, which I've already emailed to you, Mary, so that you didn't, you could refer to.
I think I missed a few.
So, and actually, I should say, and I know we're still within a motion, my number was higher. My number might have been the highest. It was like 4.11, and I'm proud of it. But I was able to come down to a 3.8, but I think I would be uncomfortable going much less than that, but I am open-minded.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to go through my list if that's okay.
Yep.
I support cutting a grade 2 teacher and a kindergarten teacher, 0.5. I support adding the math teacher of 0.5. The middle school, I support keeping the staffing as is. High school, I absolutely support keeping the staffing as is. I think we should leave our nursing levels as they are currently. If we have another year of significant difficulties in finding substitute nurses, then I think we have a trend that we will have to respond to. I'm hoping it was just a really odd situation, or unusual situation. High school coaches, I have been all over on the map on this. I think how I'm going to come down on this is that I believe the JV coaches are in response to an increase in a number of students who are interested in playing. I don't like the idea of cutting students because I too agree that it is part of the educational process and all students should have an opportunity to play, so I would agree to funding those and only those. Obviously, we're going to live up to our promise of the turf field investment amount. And let me see. I'll just give me 1 second. Kevin, I support your idea of bringing the level up to what was actually expended in professional development. I'm really not sure of what we would achieve by switching $50,000 out of district placement to contingency. It's basically a wash, so. If you want to move the monies around, that's fine. It's not going to impact our bottom line.
Exactly.
And I believe that summarizes my position.
Thank you. Anybody else want to add, subtract, multiply? No. Kevin, you made a motion.
Did?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can I just add something?
Yes.
When I went through my calculations, I came up with 3.8. That is the number I am most comfortable with. I am very concerned about going down to 3.6 without any specification as to where those cuts would be made. That's it. Thank you.
Can I just ditto that? And I, even though I said before that I didn't support cuts when we went through the list, I don't support cuts at the high school either. I would leave that staffing and finagling the numbers. I came out with about 3.8% increase.
Kevin. Would you read your motion again, please?
If anyone remembers it.
So, because I think we're a little fuzzy on that one.
Okay.
It's about an hour and a half ago.
The gist of the motion is, in terms of dollars and cents, 3.6%. As I've already indicated to everybody, I don't consider that a carved in stone number. And therefore, I could consider amending the motion and or putting it to a vote, letting the chips fall where they may. So I know what I would prefer to do, but.
Well, you made the motion, so you either stick with your motion or you amend it.
Well, I haven't heard anybody suggest specifically. I've heard some specific numbers, but I've heard an equal number, The bottom line is, other than the 3.6, it's and charge the superintendent and district leadership team with adjusting the difference of, under my calculations, $124,061 in accordance with sound educational policy and practice with consideration for class size issues.
So, Kevin, can you consider amending?
Yes, I would like to ask the second. Can you consider amending?
Yeah, I'm listening.
So you've either got to amend it or you've got to withdraw it.
Well,
could I?
notwithstanding Peter's comment in the state subsidy, which is an unknown. The difference between a 3.8% increase and a 3.6% increase is $7 a year for the average homeowner.
Nah, it's only $6.93.
$6.93 per year for an average $250 home.
What is it dollar-wise? Do you have that?
$78.24 would be a 3.8% increase.
No, no. I mean, what is the total?
Oh, the dollar. You're going to make me use a shell.
Without pill.
Okay, so the dollar figure between 3.8 and 3.6 is
$6.93.
$36.400. Oh, no. Wait a minute. That's not right. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Hold on.
I'm getting tired here.
Okay. Yeah.
Between the 3.8 and the 3.6, is that what you asked me?
Yes.
It's $36,488. That's what she
was looking for. What? Difference in
the
term.
Increase at 3.8 is 693,283. The difference at 3.6 is 656,795.
Oh yeah, okay.
Is that what you're asking? I'm
no,
sorry.
That's not what I was asking.
Okay, I apologize.
No, that's what Kathy was asking.
She was asking for total for the total increase.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
That's what I was asking.
What's I'm sorry.
36.5.
Is the difference between 3.8? And you said you wouldn't quibble over $22,000, Kevin.
Yeah, I did, didn't I?
So this is, and this is only 36.
I would like to cautiously, does anybody have bricks?
No.
No bricks?
Don't forget what I got.
And I've used that on people. Revise the motion to the extent that it would be 3.8%. And you all can figure out the dollars and cents that go to the total budget amount, but I'll amend to 3.8% with the same philosophical direction to the superintendent and the district leadership team. And a quick note on why I'm doing that is I'm not an educator. I may be a policy wonk, I may be a finance wonk, but I am not an educator, and that's why as a board member I look to hire people like Alan, and through Alan, people like our administrators here to make those decisions. So that's where I am on that. And if there's a second, we can proceed.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Now there's something new to discuss. And we do have to give that option to discuss where people would be, where people would stand on the 3.8 if they wish to say something.
I'll support it.
Okay.
I can support it. I believe in the scheme of things, it's an inconsequential change in terms of dollars and cents that may have some consequential changes for our students. And when all is said and done,
okay,
that's why we do what we do.
Left-hand side of the room? Anybody want to say whether they're planning on supporting that or not planning on supporting that?
I am comfortable supporting that.
I feel like you're about to say something.
I feel like I've talked so much tonight. I will support it. I think, to your point, Kathy, earlier about some of the factors in our environment that we do need to consider, but I go back to Kevin's sign that it's about the kids and the decisions I think we've all agonized over, and I do mean agonized, everybody here. Really, the bottom line is we want to do the best that we can for our students first and foremost. And then, to me, that's the priority. Then I factor in those other things, which I did factor in. I don't think 3.8 is irresponsible given the needs of our students.
Linda, Peter, do you want to say anything?
I'd like to move the question.
Okay.
And I am in support at this time, but it's 9:30.
Yep.
It's time to go.
Yay.
Okay. Nobody else has anything to say? All right. All in favor of Kevin's motion of 3.8? Blah, blah, blah.
Sounds good at 9:30.
It does. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you.
Can we applaud ourselves?
Mea culpa. Mea
mea culpa. Now we need plotters.
We get a couple plotters.
Yeah. Wheels. Feel that need to relax.
Holy moly.
11F, retirement.
Right.
Oh my gosh.
Can we stop?
We're not.
Sorry.
We still have an agenda.
We got to do a report.
I have one retirement. This, really? This document just came in to me today. And I've talked with this person, or I emailed with this person, and to be sure this is correct. So what I have in front of me, and I will pass to each of you, is a letter from Ren Wilkinson, who is saying that, remember I talked to you earlier about taking a leave of absence. After a lot of discussion with my family, I think it will be better for me if I retire outright. Thank you for being so solicitous of my needs. I have had a wonderful career here. I think all of you would look at that as something that you sadly see happen.
Is there one more?
Yeah.
My kids didn't get there in time.
Any more comments on that?
Do we need to actually...
No, we can't do anything about it.
Okay, I didn't think so.
That's an FYI.
Yeah, I think right?
That's
an
a great law.
Yeah.
There's a policy that says that you can accept resignations. And
you can accept them? Okay. Do you want to vote on it then?
No.
As long as we're all right.
The policy
there is a policy that says
authority to accept resignations.
All right, that's what I thought. That's why I wasn't sure I was understanding. Okay. 11G, Kevin. Karen Seif.
Okay, let's start off with 11G. My motion is to direct the superintendent and the district leadership team, in consultation with whomever they feel necessary and appropriate, to examine the issue of scheduling as it impacts class size, and to come back to the board at a point in time, hopefully before September, but if not, you know, we can talk about that. To contrast the various types of schedules and their pros and cons, so we have a full picture in front of us of what it means to us. And at the same time, to direct the policy committee, and I don't mean to use that kind of language, Trish, but it kind of works, to review the class size and teacher loads with a view to reducing those numbers to the Baldacci acceptable number of 17 or thereabouts, whatever is appropriate. And I'd like to see that happen through a subcommittee of the policy committee.
That was a fairly long
motion.
That's
a really long motion. You might want to separate them.
Yeah, separate it. I don't want to create another subcommittee,
okay.
But I'll look at the class guide.
All right. The first motion one is to direct the superintendent and district leadership team to examine school schedules and all school schedules and develop the pros and cons of various school schedules as they impact class size and or teacher load. That's motion number one.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Is there a discussion? All in favor? Did you want to say something before I did the all in favor, Rebecca?
Never mind.
Okay, I'm sorry. And opposed? 7-0? Okay, Kevin, you took it out of order I had.
Number two is that we ask, there's a better word, we ask the policy committee to establish a subcommittee to examine the issue of class sizes and teacher loads in the Cape Elizabeth School District in order to bring them into accordance with the most current guidelines.
That's good.
Is there a second?
No second.
Trish? Discussion?
Since you're in a flexible mode of amending your motions, can we amend it to say the policy committee will address it and the policy committee will decide whether subcommittee is necessary?
Yeah. Actually, that's more friendly.
Which it may result in a subcommittee.
No, no.
I'm thinking here, maybe it makes sense to have teacher input, other people. I just don't know, but we'd like to have.
When we put on our policy WOMCATs, we can make that decision. So, yeah, that's, I have no problem.
So the amended motion should read, ask the policy committee to examine class size and teacher load?
Yes.
Rather than, okay.
Okay.
With the view towards using the most current guidelines.
I have all the rest of it.
Good.
Okay, we have a motion, we have a second. Additional discussion? No? All in favor? Opposed, 0, 7, 0.
Last one. Learning with pleasure that CEF has asked Karen to be their representative or our representative or some type of liaison between these organizations. I would like to move that the school board affirm our appointment of Karen as our representative to the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation.
Is there a second? Rebecca, thank you. Discussion?
Am I allowed to vote on this?
Yes, you are.
Okay.
All in favor?
Conflict of interest?
Yeah, let's see if you vote. Oh. I'm watching your vote.
That's going to happen.
You'll get a 3.8% increase in yours. All in favor? 7-0. Anything else you want to throw in here, Kevin?
No, please, no.
Well, listen, yeah, if I can keep getting 7-0.
You're done.
You're done.
Okay, committee reports. They're going to be brief, right, guys?
Yes.
Finance committee, Rebecca. Oh, thank you. Oh, no, go ahead.
I'll be really quick. We met on March 28th. We talked about the baseball booster, which you folks voted on this evening. We also discussed booster financial reporting, and Alan is going to be working on that. We reviewed the food service report and agreed that we should have a joint committee with the wellness group to look at changes at the lunch program. We reviewed the energy report, nothing substantial. The next meeting will be held Wednesday, April 25th at 8:30.
Thank you. And I just would mention to anybody who's watching or in the audience that minutes for committees are on the web. So if you want full minutes, you can go on the website and see them. Krish, policy committee.
We've met twice, March 20th and April 4th. Most of our discussion we've already talked about, which were the policies that were presented. There's a couple others that are sort of in discussion, most of them coming out of the extracurricular committee, which has been very busy and productive. Related to the turf field guidelines, there's still a lot of things that are up in the air. We are meeting next on, we didn't set our date, it'll be the third Tuesday of May. I'll get back to you on that.
Thank you, Trish. Personnel, Linda.
Personnel committee met on March 15th. We reviewed the two job descriptions that were presented earlier this evening. As well, we went through hiring procedures for head coaches out of the hiring procedures manual. It is not a policy. Revisions have been made and sent on to Alan for his review. Our next committee meeting is April 19th.
Oh, I'm sorry. See, I had Trish on, thank you. I had Trish on one side and then I just flipped you over and I just blew right by you, sorry. Communications.
Very short. We haven't had a formal meeting, but Karen and I have spent a lot of time organizing the View publication. A huge thanks to all of those staff members throughout the system who provided information on that. And we hope to have that out in people's mailboxes the end of the week after April vacation.
Thank you. Strategic planning. Trish.
We met on April 9th. We are continuing working on the goal statements with the supporting objectives. And we will be providing that information to the DLT with a, sort of in summary form for their input as we continue to refine it. It's exciting work, but challenging to sort of capture all the essence of all the data that we collected.
Thank you. Extracurricular. Linda.
Yes, we met on April 3rd. Got a quick update from Keith on the status of the turf field. Received an email this afternoon, and it sounds like construction has actually started on the field. They received all the permits that they needed. We'll continue to monitor the progress of the field, but it should be 6 to 8 weeks, and hopefully won't create any interruption to the normal school day for any kids. We continued our discussions on policies for gate receipts and admissions, a lot of them revolving around the turf field. We still have some work yet to do on that. We started our work on some of the other policies for the evaluation of coaches, and again, we'll be continuing work on that. Our next meeting is May 1st at 3 o'clock.
Thank you. Wellness, Rebecca.
We met on April 2nd at the fire station. We had a speaker, Dr. Lisa Letourneau, who is a physician and one of the founders of Scarborough's Wellness Initiative. She spoke to us about the process of forming their wellness policy in their community. It was very insightful. We are going to be meeting again on May 7th in the fire station hall, and we are fortunate to be having Tori Rogers from Let's Go as our speaker. The Wellness Committee also agreed to set up a joint committee with the Finance Committee, and we have a number of people who are interested in serving.
Is that a separate committee, Rebecca? I'm confused.
It's going to be a joint committee. So the Finance Committee will meet with some members of the Wellness Committee. Since there's three members of the Finance Committee, I figure all can probably attend without any problem. And then we have about six members of the Wellness Committee to talk about the lunch program issue.
Okay. Thank you. Paths, Kevin.
We unanimously adopted the budget. And the other information will be in your mailboxes.
Thank you. Legislative Liaison, Rebecca.
I just have one question to everybody. There are so many bills that are up in Augusta that deal with education that I don't know how we as a board are going to deal with this. We cannot write a letter of position statement for each one. Perhaps what I would like to do is ask Alan to just sift through it, pick the ones that he thinks have a chance of passing that would be detrimental to our schools, and let us know, and then we can try to deal with it.
Great. Thank you. Technology, Linda.
We met on March 21st, continued revising the district's technology plan. We got through three more sections. We now have two more meetings left, and I believe there's only three sections left to go. And Gary has a draft of all the revisions up on the school website under technology. So if you'd like to take a look at all the work that's taken place, it's up there for you to see.
Thank you.
Next meeting is April 24th.
Thank you. Public comment. You don't see any. Do I? No? Okay.
The audience wants to go home.
I do too. School board agenda requests. No. Can we forego the announcement of upcoming meetings? We've covered most of them.
Yes.
Do I hear a motion?
I move we adjourn.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor? Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy.